Welcome to Valley Presbyterian Church's online worship service. We hope you enjoy the following call to worship and celebration of Jesus' entry to Jerusalem as we celebrate Palm Sunday.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever.
Let Israel say, God's steadfast love endures forever.
Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter into them and give thanks to the Lord. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it.
The street is sure crowded today.
Some people are talking about a king.
I heard somebody say that a king is coming.
Let me climb up on your shoulders. I'll look for the king.
Look for a chariot.
Or a white horse.
Kings usually ride in chariots.
Sometimes they ride on white horses.
All I see is a man on a donkey. People are calling him Jesus. Watch out for the palm branches.
People are waving palm branches all over.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever.
Hosanna in the highest, blessed is he.
Hosanna, Hosanna, the little children say. Through pillar, court, and temple, the lovely anthem rang. To Jesus, who had blessed the most folded to his breast, the children sang their praises, the simplest and the best.
Welcome. I'm Pastor Jenny Warner, and I'm so glad that you've joined us in worship at Valley Presbyterian Church on this Palm Sunday as we follow Jesus in his procession into Jerusalem. This week, as we are going to be celebrating Holy Week in our own homes, we'll be sending you spiritual practices every day that you can engage in from home. If you're not signed up for our newsletter, just go to our homepage at valleypresschurch.org and sign up, and we'll be happy to share those with you. As you prepare for worship right now, I'd like to invite you to find a candle and light it, to find something that will pass for bread, and find some sort of liquid in a cup as we'll be celebrating communion later in the service. And as we begin, I invite you to take a deep breath, inhaling the struggle and the pain of this world, and exhaling with the word Hosanna, Lord, save us, help. As we join the crowds on the streets of Jerusalem, welcoming Jesus. Let us worship together.
The scripture reading this morning comes from Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. If you want to follow along, we're reading from the New International Version of the Bible.
In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage.
Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness.
And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross.
Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name.
That at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth.
And every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
For the word in God, of God in Scripture.
For the word of God among us.
For the word of God within us.
Thanks be to God.
This week I have been amazed as people have taken the Scripture to heart and have found ways to humble themselves before each other and take on the nature of a servant, and to give of their time and resources so that others may feel safe. All throughout the country, people are finding ways to connect and to serve. like the college students who are offering to Zoom and tutor the younger kids on their block, or the woman who held story time outside her house, reading books from her porch while kids listened scattered throughout the lawn, or the teacher who rode through his neighborhood on his bike, waving hello to the young kindergartners who miss him so much. Somehow we are finding ways to remain close in spirit, even when we are physically far apart. Somehow we have found what it means to be truly human, to recognize it is when we feel the least powerful that we can be strong, and when we feel the weakest that we have the most to give. Today we are celebrating Palm Sunday, another day wrapped up in contradictions, for as Jesus rode through the city, not on a horse like a warrior, nor wearing fine clothes or covered in jewels like a potential king might, but instead riding into Jerusalem with a simple robe and on a donkey, proclaiming a new kind of kingdom and a new kind of king. And while Jesus was able to be out amongst the crowds, amidst people packed together tightly, singing and waving branches, he too was confined. Of course, Jesus was not housebound, sheltering in place. Jesus didn't even have a home. But instead, he was confined by the rules and traditions of his day. Instead, Jesus was confined by the expectation that he would free his people by overthrowing a government. He was confined by the expectation that he would join the scribes and other religious leaders, ascending through their ranks and promoting their kind of religion. Yet Jesus did none of this. Instead of biding in a few days in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus would actually heal the ear of a Roman soldier who was out to attack him. Instead of adhering to the religious norms of the day, Jesus would overturn the tables of the money changers in the temple courts and shout out, "It is written, my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers." Healing the blind, giving sight to those who need it, causing children to shout out, "Hosanna, the Son of David, Hosanna in the highest," confusing and infuriating the chief priests and the scribes even more, Jesus would contradict and upend everything people thought he was there to do. Yet set in this scene, screaming and getting angry, then healing and teaching and preaching about the future, we see the full scope of Jesus's life on earth. We see both Jesus's humanity and Christ's divinity. And then, even though Jesus could have chosen many paths, he chooses the cross. And our scripture reminds us for this morning that Jesus humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. I am struck here by the phrase, obedient to death. And looking at how a country like South Korea has been able to flatten their curve so dramatically, it is often cited that South Korea has a very obedient population, and how respectfulness and communal interests have made it easier to shelter in place, to enforce hand washing and other containment measures. Yet while these are huge accomplishments, I myself have struggled to be obedient even to staying within my own home, of not feeling frustration or anger that our family won't be traveling to San Diego to visit grandma and to be on some spring break adventure. I'm not sure what kind of fortitude it would take to be obedient to death on a cross. And while this particular section of scripture does not go into further detail about what death on a cross looks like, we do get a glimpse of what comes next. We get a sneak peek at Easter, when scripture reminds us that God exalted Jesus to the highest place. God raised him up and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God. In this scripture, we discover, or perhaps even rediscover, that obedience to God does not lead to death, but rather death is the vehicle through which we are raised up to a new life in Christ. I wonder what this revelation can teach us about our own call to obedience today. Josh Groban, in his song, You Raise Me Up, talks about how when he is weary, when he is burdened or troubled, how he sits in silence and how God sits with him. And then after he and God are together, after the suffering and the pain, how God raises him up so that he can do the impossible and be more than he could be when God is with him. This week, as we reflect on Christ's journey to the cross, as we remembering the suffering and look to the resurrection, I invite you to take heart. For while we may be weary and burdened, God is with us to lift us up and to empower us to be more than we can be. Amen.
In offering our lives to God, we offer God our obedience, our time, our talent, and our treasure. Together, let us reflect on these things as we reflect on this song.
When I am down, and oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come, and my heart burden be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be.
Today, we are not able to gather together physically, but our hearts still yearn for the forgiveness and for the community that communion provides. So I invite you to pause to gather up some bread and something for the cup as we share a moment together.
I love you, Mama.
I love you too, Colin. This is a meal of love, and all are welcome at God's table. So we invite you now to open your hearts to God as God has opened his heart to us. God is with us.
We are not alone.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
Let us give our thanks and praise.
Just before that long night in the Garden of Gethsemane, before Jesus' arrest, before he was betrayed, Christ took bread. And after giving thanks to God, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." That's for you. And after supper, Christ took the cup and poured it out and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the saving death of the risen Lord until he comes again. The gifts of God for the people of God. Together, let us eat this bread."
Yeah.
That's right. You can dip it in too. Together, let us drink from the cup of salvation.
It's like
the bread of life, the cup of salvation. Amen.
We give thanks for the gift of this meal as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, praying, Our God who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
It's at this point in the service when we're in the sanctuary on Palm Sunday that we'll often drape a cross in black cloth to help us prepare to go into Holy Week. But since we'll be making our Holy Week journey from home this week, I'd like to invite you to create a space in your house for Holy Week. Maybe it's a side table or your dining room table or a corner shelf. Here's my space at home where I often pray and journal and read. Find a dark cloth to drape over the table. Find some sort of a sacred object. Maybe it's a cross. Here I've put my favorite icon of Christ. If appropriate, light a candle. And then every day this week, we'll send you a practice in the mornings to invite you into reflection on Jesus' journey to the cross. You can come back into this small space to engage in those practices. But for today, a dark cloth, a cross, and a candle will remind you to be intentional about entering into this week. We certainly don't need reminders that life is a hard journey, but if you're like me, you may need a reminder that God is with us in it.
And now may God empower you to be more than you can be as God raises you up and blesses you abundantly this week. Amen.